Paul Joseph Goebbels was born on October 29, 1897, in Rhine Province, Kingdom of Prussia, German Empire. Both of his parents were Roman Catholics with modest family backgrounds. Goebbels had five siblings. During childhood, Goebbels suffered from ill health, which included a long bout of inflammation of the lungs. He had a deformed right foot that turned inwards due to a congenital deformity. It was thicker and shorter than his left foot. He underwent a failed operation to correct it just prior to starting grammar school. Goebbels wore a metal brace and special shoe because of his shortened leg and walked with a limp. He was rejected from military service in the German Empire Army during the First World War due to his deformity. Goebbels was educated at a Christian gymnasium where he completed his university entrance examination in 1917. He was the top student of his class and was given the traditional honor to speak at the award ceremony. At the University of Heidelberg, Goebbels wrote his doctoral thesis on Wilhelm von Schutz, a minor 19th century romantic dramatist. He had hoped to write his thesis under the supervision of Friedrich Gundorf, who at the time was a well-known literary historian. Gundorf was no longer teaching, so directed Goebbels to his associate professor Max Friedrich von Waldburg. Waldburg recommended Goebbels write his thesis on Wilhelm von Schutz. After submitting the thesis and passing his oral examination, Goebbels earned his PhD in 1921. Goebbels then returned home and worked as a private tutor. He also found work as a journalist and was published in the local newspaper. His writing during this time reflected his growing anti-Semitism and dislike for modern culture. He continued for several years to try to become a published author. His diaries, which he began in 1923 and continued for the rest of his life, provided an outlet for his desire to write. The lack of income from his literary works forced him to take up jobs as a caller on the stock exchange and as a bank clerk in Cologne, German Empire. He was dismissed from the bank in August 1923 and returned to Ried. During this period, he read avidly and was influenced by the works of Houston Stuart Chamberlain, the British-born German writer whose book, The Foundations of the 19th Century, was one of the standard works of the extreme right in Germany. Goebbels first took an interest in Adolf Hitler and Nazism in 1924. Goebbels was drawn to the NSDAP mostly because of Hitler's charisma and commitment to his beliefs. He joined the NSDAP around this time. In late 1924, Goebbels offered his service to Karl Kaufmann, who was NSDAP district leader for the Rhine-Ruhr district. Kaufmann put him in touch with Gregor Strasser, a leading Nazi organizer in northern Germany, who hired him to work on a weekly newspaper and to do secretarial work for the regional party offices. He was also put to work as party speaker and representative of Rhineland-Westphalia. After reading Hitler's book, My Struggle, Goebbels found himself agreeing with Hitler's assertion of a Jewish doctrine of Marxism. In February 1926, Goebbels gave a speech titled Lenin or Hitler, in which he asserted that communism or Marxism could not save the German people, but he believed it would cause a social national state to arise in Russia. Goebbels was first offered the position of party district leader for the Berlin section in August 1926. He traveled to Berlin in mid-September and by the middle of October accepted the position. Goebbels was given control over the local stormtroopers and protection squadron and answered only to Hitler. Goebbels adopted recent developments in commercial advertising to the political sphere. In late April 1930, Hitler publicly and firmly announced his opposition to Gregor Strasser and appointed Goebbels to replace him as realm leader of NSDAP propaganda. In late 1913, Goebbels met Magda Quandt, a divorcee who had joined the party a few months earlier. Joseph and Magda married on December 19, 1931. To celebrate Hitler's appointment as chancellor, Goebbels organized a torchlit parade in Berlin on the night of January 30th of an estimated 60,000 men, many in the uniforms of the stormtroopers and protection squadron. Goebbels had to deal with Hitler's. On August 2nd, 1934, President von Hindenburg died. In a radio broadcast, Goebbels announced that the offices of president and chancellor had been combined and Hitler had been formally named as leader and chancellor. Throughout 1935 and 1936, hundreds of clergy and nuns were arrested, often on false charges of currency smuggling or sexual offenses. His speech on May 28th in Berlin in front of 20,000 party members, which was also broadcast on the radio, attacked the Catholic Church as morally corrupt. Partly out of foreign policy concerns, Hitler ordered a scaling back of the church struggle by the end of July 1937. In 1936, Goebbels met a Czech actress, and by the winter of 1937 began an intense affair with her. Magda had a long conversation with Hitler about it on August 15, 1938. Unwilling to put up with a scandal involving one of his top ministers, Hitler demanded that Goebbels break off the relationship. Thereafter, Joseph and Magda seemed to reach a truce until the end of September. The couple had another falling out at that point, and once again Hitler became involved, insisting the couple stay together. Hitler arranged for publicity photos to be taken of himself with the reconciled couple in October. Magda too had affairs, including a relationship in 1933 and in 1938. In the lead-up to the Sudetenland crisis in 1938, Goebbels took the time to use propaganda to whip up sympathy for the Sudeten Germans while campaigning against the Czech government. After the Western powers acceded to Hitler's demands concerning Czechoslovakia in 1938, Goebbels soon redirected his propaganda machine against Poland. During the Second World War, the propaganda ministry took over the broadcasting facilities of conquered countries immediately after surrender and began broadcasting prepared material using the existing announcers as a way to gain trust of the citizens. Hitler made fewer public appearances and broadcasts as the war progressed, so Goebbels increasingly became the voice of the Nazi regime for the German people. Goebbels dealt with increasingly serious shortages of necessities, such as food and clothing, as well as the need to ration beer and tobacco, which were important for morale. Hitler suggested watering down the beer and degrading the quality of cigarettes so that more could be produced faster, but Goebbels refused, saying the cigarettes were already of such low quality that it was impossible to make them any worse. While Goebbels had been pressing for expulsion of the Berlin Jews since 1935, there were still 62,000 living in the city in 1940. Part of the delay in their deportation was that they were needed as workers in the armament industry. Deportations of German Jews began in October 1940, with the first transport from Berlin leaving on October 18th. Some Jews were shot immediately on arrival in destinations such as Riga, Latvia, and Kaunas, Lithuania. In preparation for the deportations, Goebbels ordered that all German Jews were required by law to wear an identifying yellow badge as of September 5, 1941. On January 15, 1943, Hitler appointed Goebbels as head of the newly created Air Raid Damage Committee, which meant Goebbels was in charge of nationwide civil air defenses and shelters, as well as the assessment and repair of damaged buildings. Partly in response for being excluded from the Committee of Three, Goebbels pressured Hitler to introduce measures that would produce total war, including closing businesses not essential to the war effort, conscripting women into the labor force, and enlisting men in previous exempt occupations into the Wehrmacht. But to Goebbels' dismay, Goering demanded that his favorite restaurants in Berlin should remain open, and Hans Lammers successfully lobbied Hitler to have women and children exempted from conscription. After the Allied invasion of Sicily in July 1943 and the strategic Soviet victory in the Battle of Kursk, Goebbels began to recognize that the war could no longer be won. Following the Allied invasion of Italy and the fall of Mussolini in September, he raised with Hitler the possibility of a separate peace either with the Soviets or with Britain. Throughout July 1944, Goebbels and Albert Speer continued to press Hitler to bring the economy to a total war footing. Over the objections of Goering, Goebbels was appointed on July 23rd as Realm Plenipotentiary of Total War, charged with maximizing the manpower and the armaments industry at the expense of sectors of the economy not critical to the war effort. Through these efforts, he was able to free up an additional 500,000 men for military service. However, as many of these new recruits came from the armaments industry, the move put him in conflict with Armament Minister Albert Speer. When other Nazi leaders urged Hitler to leave Berlin and establish a new center of resistance in the National Redoubt in Bavaria, Goebbels opposed this, arguing for a heroic last stand in Berlin. His family, except for Magda's son Harald, moved into their house in Berlin to await the end. By this time, Goebbels had gained the position he had wanted so long, at the side of Hitler. Most of Hitler's inner circle, including Goering, Himmler, Ribbentrop, and Speer, prepared to leave Berlin immediately after Hitler's birthday celebration on April 20th. After midnight on April 29th, with the Soviets advancing ever closer to the bunker complex, Hitler married Eva Braun in a small civil ceremony. Afterwards, Hitler hosted a modest wedding breakfast with his new wife. In the mid-afternoon of April 30th, Hitler shot himself. Goebbels was depressed and stated that he would walk around the Chancery Garden until he was killed by Russian shelling. On May 1st, Goebbels completed his sole official act as Chancellor. He dictated a letter to General Vasilev Chuyokov and ordered German General Hans Krebs to deliver it under a white flag. Chuyokov, as commander of the Soviet 8th Guards Army, commanded the Soviet forces in central Berlin. Goebbels' letter informed Chuyokov of Hitler's death and requested a ceasefire. After this was rejected, Goebbels decided that further efforts were futile. On the evening of May 1st, Goebbels arranged for an SS dentist, Helmut Kunz, to inject his 6 children with morphine so that when they were unconscious, an ampoule of cyanide could be then crushed in each of their mouths. But it was Magda Goebbels, with Hitler's personal doctor, who administrated the cyanide. At around 20:30, Joseph and Magda left the bunker and walked up the garden of the Chancery, where they committed suicide. The bodies were then doused with petrol, but they were only partially burned and not buried. If you like this video, then feel free to click the like button. If you want to subscribe or comment, please do so. You can help financially support the channel by donating on my Patreon page. And you can also follow me on Twitter and Instagram, links in the description. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I bid you farewell.